I bring greetings to you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Welcome to Igola Yopuna Global Outreach. I am Brother Hosanna David. I want to talk about God's grace. This is a message the Lord gave to me about the grace of God. I have been doing a Bible teaching for the past few weeks on God's grace. The Lord decided to give me a dream. He spoke to me and explained a lot of things to me about the grace of God. This has actually opened my eyes to a deeper understanding, to having a deeper understanding about the grace of God. And I want to share this message with you. Let us pray before I share this message. Lord our God, we ask that you receive all glory and praise, dominion and power. Thank you for sending Jesus Christ, your only begotten Son, to come and die for us. Grace and truth came through Jesus. Lord, enlighten us. Shine your light upon our hearts and help us to understand grace. And also help us to make good use of this free gift of eternal life that you have given to us. Help us to accept it. Help us to understand the kind of love you have for us so that we don't abuse it. Open the hearts of your children to listen to your word and to understand it. Help as many who do not know you to know your love for them, the depth of it, the height and the breadth of your love, so that they can embrace it and turn from their evil ways and start living the kind of life, the life of righteousness that you have prescribed for us. Thank you, Holy Father. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Before we continue, please share this video and also subscribe to this channel. Share this video to people. Let them know the truth. So I had a dream on the 8th of November 2022. In this dream, I was lying down. I was sleeping in the dream. And then I got a message from the Lord while I was lying down. And the message was about hellfire. I learned that some people were going to be in hell for eternity, for everlasting. When I got a message from the Lord, I started crying. I was weeping. As I was weeping, the Holy Spirit started speaking to me. He said to me, "Tell my people that those who believe in me, even if they are weak, let them not stop doing good. Let them not stop believing in my name. Let them keep believing in me. Let them keep striving, because God is a merciful God." Then he quoted Romans chapter 10 verse 13. "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." My understanding of what the Lord was telling me was that there are some of his children who are giving up because they are weak in terms of struggling with their weaknesses, their bad characters, their addictions, after accepting the Lord into their lives, after their repentance. But because of their personal weaknesses, they tend to give up. Some will conclude that since I'm not even meeting up to the standard that the Lord actually wants me to be, why not I just give up? I think I'm not good enough. I keep falling into sin. What the Lord is saying here is that even if you are weak, don't give up. Keep believing. Keep striving. As we move on in this message, you are going to understand why the Lord is encouraging his children never to give up. A lot of us think that we can please God with our own strength. No. I am a typical example. I've come to understand that nobody can please God with their own strength. You can't follow God with your own strength. "For by strength shall no man prevail." 1 Samuel chapter 2 verse 9. Look at what Jesus Christ said in Revelation chapter 3 verse 8. He says, "I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, and has not denied my faith." The Lord knows your strength. He knows when you have little strength. These people here They have little strength, as the Lord has rightly said. Yet they were able to keep the word of the Lord. There is difference between being strong in faith. Being strong as a Christian, as a believer. Being a matured and strong Christian. There's difference between that and obeying the Lord. Obedience is beyond strength. You can be strong and choose to disobey. You can be weak and choose to obey. Jesus Christ said, "For thou hast a little strength and hast kept my word and hast not denied my name." You may fall, but so long as you are willing to obey and to follow, you keep rising and keep running after your Maker. You keep running after your Savior. Obedience is very, very important. After that moment, I was sent, in that same dream, I was sent a message. I looked at the message and I saw a link. The link was from Eternity website. It was, I could see it, something like eternitywebsite.com, but I don't actually know the true address of that website, but I knew it was from Eternity website. And the link, I could read the title of the message, 150 years in hell, in that same dream. Again, that same night, as I was sleeping, I heard the voice of the Holy Spirit saying to someone, "Do not start living in immorality because you feel you are not good enough in the sight of God. Do this and you will make heaven." There are some people who get discouraged because they feel that they are not good enough. They judge themselves and they feel, "Well, I'm not good enough. Why do I even need to continue to try? Why not I just enjoy my life so that I know that I know my destination? Why try and fail and go to hell at the end? Why not I just settle for evil?" So this is what the Lord is saying to this category of people. "Do this and you will make heaven. Cast the burden of your weakness upon your Savior. Surrender your life to Him and He will live in you through His Spirit." The truth is that a lot of people think that they can use their own strength, their personal power, to please God and follow God. That's exactly the kind of mistake that Peter made when he boasted that he will never deny Jesus Christ. But thank God Jesus Christ interceded for him. Philippians chapter 2 verse 13 says, "It is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure." Then the Lord said to me, "Nobody has ever made it into heaven by their own power." 1 Samuel chapter 2 verse 9 says, "For by strength shall no man prevail." Romans chapter 9 15 and 16 says, "For he said to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion." A lot of people think that by their own power, they can make it into heaven. But the Lord said, by one's own strength, they cannot make it into heaven. That nobody has ever been to heaven by their own power. It is God who wills and works in us, not our own strength. And then he continued, "No human effort is good enough to earn him eternal life. Salvation is by grace through faith in Jesus Christ." Ephesians 2:8, "For by grace ye are saved through faith, and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God." Then he continued, "I am the Lord your Savior. I came to save because man cannot save himself. Now that I have come, accept me and allow me to save you despite your weaknesses. I knew how weak you are before I came to save you." Romans 5 verse 6 says, "For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly." That was the message I received that day. Then on the 9th of November 2022, the Holy Spirit spoke the following words to me concerning the same message. It's a continuation of what he had already told me. God does not complicate the way of salvation. We have only one aim: to save mankind. The God who has resolved to save does not bring any stumbling block. I am the Lord. Tell my people that I am not just love, but I am mercy. He that has come to save does not introduce a stumbling block before himself. That is what he means here, that he is out to save and he has determined to save. In a vision, I saw a wooden plank. This wooden plank is the type that people use in some of these underdeveloped countries. They bring the, for instance, let me see, this is a plank. Let me try to use this. This is a plank. So what they do is that they put long nails, like 6-inch nails. They pierce it through the plank. And if they want an upcoming vehicle to stop, they put it across the road. And the vehicle stops because the vehicle can't climb it. If it climbs it, the tire could get spoiled, could be punctured by the nails. So I saw that kind of plank with nails, pointed nails. I saw that it was being removed from a tarred road. And then I heard a voice that said, "Do I obstruct myself? Why should I bring a stumbling block before the very works of my own hands? I have determined to save, and I am also ready to save. Tell my preachers not to complicate the gospel that saves. The salvation gospel is saved through faith in Jesus Christ alone. No law, no works and services are required. I have come to save, therefore I want to save as many that want to escape the great fiery judgment. If you, my preachers, had known how fierce the fire of hell looks, you would have not complicated the gospel of salvation. Instead, you would have gone after the sinners and the weak to pull them from the path of destruction. You would not have looked down on them as people who are condemned and as people who do not deserve mercy and forgiveness. Tell them that my name is Mercy." Tell them, is referring to preachers. Tell them to go after the lost. I am out there waiting for the preachers to scatter the seeds for me to water them and protect and germinate them. All souls are mine. No soul is more important than the other. They are all my breath. As a madman, so is a priest. They are only different in their callings and the works they have done on earth. All souls are equal." After that message, it stopped. I didn't get any other message. Then on the 10th of November 2022, the Lord continued with the same message and he started speaking to me. He said to me, "Let every Christian pick up a gong and play it about." A gong is a local instrument. They use it, the town criers, they use it to pass a message. When they want to pass a message, they ring it. That's the way they ring it, and people will pay attention. They will know that, oh, the town crier wants to pass a message. So he said, "Let every Christian pick up a gong and play it about. Let them announce that people should repent because Jesus Christ is coming soon. It is the duty of every Christian to preach. Evangelism is not the work of the pastor alone. It is the work of every saved Christian. We are saved not to feel safe within ourselves, but we are saved to save others. We are not saved to hide the gospel of salvation. If it had been hidden from us, we wouldn't have been saved. So We are saved so that we can go out and save others, no matter the risk we may face when we go out to preach. Personally, as I was receiving these messages, I had some level of arguments inside of me. The argument is that, am I going to begin to sound like some of those who preach grace as a license to sin? Because I have been doing teachings on God's grace. And when the Lord laid emphasis on no works, just faith, I was kind of, are people not going to misunderstand this message? Even though the message wasn't through, I was having this battle inside of me. Then the Lord knew that I had this battle inside of me, and He decided to explain to me. This is the explanation He gave to me. He said to me, "What is difficult there that you do not understand? Nobody works for salvation. Working for salvation means saving oneself. Jesus saves all those who believe. They do not work for the new life they receive. It is a gift from God. I give the garment of righteousness for free. What people see as work is keeping the garment clean always. It is in our nature to be pure. Therefore, it is the responsibility of anyone who receives this free gift of righteousness to keep it clean from impurities. Have I ever rejected any of my children because of stains in this free gift of righteousness? I have not. Rather, they reject me. They reject me by deliberately leaving their garments unwashed and with wrinkles. What is the work of the blood of the new covenant? Why do my children neglect the blood that washes them clean without cost?" Revelation chapter 7 verse 14 says, "And I said unto him, Sir, thou knowest. And he said to me, These are they which came out of great tribulation, and have washed their robes, and made them white in the blood of the Lamb." The blood of Jesus does not just save us, but as long as we continue to live in this earth, the blood of Jesus washes away our sins. So what the Lord is saying is that He doesn't cast us off because we have stains in our garments, because there is provision for us to wash it. And that provision is the blood of Jesus Christ. Whenever there is stain, we are to wash it. Whenever we fall, whenever we sin, we repent and wash it. "I do not reject my children because of stains on their garments of righteousness. It is their refusal to keep it clean that leads to their rejection." This is very, very important. Please let us read 1 John chapter 1, verses 8 to 10, and then chapter 2, 1 and 2. "If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us." The John speaking, this John, Apostle John, wasn't unsaved. As at when he wrote this, he was already old and he was saved. But he was saying that we are saints in Christ. We have imputed righteousness, and we also do good works. We don't live in sin. But if we say we have no sin, that we don't make mistakes at all, we deceive ourselves. And the truth is not in us. As humans, we make mistakes. Even look at Peter. Peter was being hypocritical. I'm talking about the one who walked on water. He was being hypocritical and was abstaining from eating with the converted Gentiles. But Paul rebuked him to his own face. There are times that this human aspect of us make us to sin. What is sin? Sin is missing the mark. This is a mark. If you miss it, you have sinned. So John is saying here that if we say that we have no sin at all, that we don't make mistakes, we don't offend the Lord at all. We make him a liar. We lie. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. Then look at chapter 2. He begins the same thing. If I were to put these into chapters, I would add the verses 1 and 2 of chapter 2 to make it so that the thought can continue in the same chapter 1. My little children, these things write I unto you, that ye sin not. And if any man sinned, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is a propitiation for our sins, and not for us only, but also for the sins of the whole world. This is what he is saying. He is saying that I am writing this to you. I'm not writing this to you to encourage you in sin, but I'm not saying that if we say we have no sin, we are liars. Because I want us to continue in sin, because I want to encourage you in sin. But that is not what I'm saying. I'm not encouraging you in sin. Rather, I am writing this to you, my little children, because I don't want you to sin, that ye sin not. But peradventure, in case you sin, if you sin by mistake, if your garment of righteousness is stained by mistake, what do you need to do? If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father. Jesus did not just die, forgave us our sins, open the gates of salvation for us to enter free of charge without cost, and then went to heaven and started receiving praise. No, Jesus Christ is still our high priest. He intercedes before the Father with his own blood. This is what a lot of people do not understand. Jesus Christ is the propitiation for our sins. This is why we don't need to give up. Who has ever told you that me, I am altogether righteous? Do you know how many times I've offended God? I'm not bragging about it, but I just want to let you know that even though a lot of people admire my lifestyle, they admire my way of Christianity, who told you that I don't sin? Who told you that I don't offend God? Do you know how stubborn I have become to God? Do you know how many times I feel ashamed before God? Do you know how many times the things that I'm supposed to do, I don't do them, and I come before God and I feel ashamed to even say, God, forgive me. I'm not saying that I live in adultery, I live in fornication. Since I gave my life to Jesus Christ, I haven't committed fornication. That is the truth. But I have lost it in my heart. I've almost fallen. There were times I did a video where I talked about how I overcame backsliding at the weakest moments of my life. After giving my life to God the second time, after making my final resolution in the year 2020, I have had weak moments in my life. One of which was in the year 2007. It was one of the most horrible years of my life. And my family people knew about it, that I was without strength. In fact, I told my brother, I can't stay alone in the house. I will backslide. It was a terrible time for me. But thank God, God has been keeping me. What I'm saying is that a Christian does not intentionally plan to commit sin. But if we say we don't commit sin at all, we don't make mistakes, we don't offend God at all, we don't miss the mark, we make him a liar. The precious blood of Jesus Christ is available to us because God wants us to keep our garment clean. He made provision for the cleansing of our garments because he knows that from time to time, even without us intending in our hearts to do it, there will be stains. So we can't say that because we are weak, we don't need to continue. The Lord knows our weakness. He is a shepherd, and in the flock, there are those that are pregnant, there are those that are sick, there are those that are injured, there are the young ones, there are those that are very, very old, there are those that can't even walk very well, there are those who have their different kind of weaknesses, and he's able to lead all of them at the same pace to the same destination. The Lord knows our weaknesses. There is no need for us at any point in time to start giving up and say, oh, since I can't even make the Lord happy, why not I just live in sin? No. This message has really touched me. The Lord had to explain to me that this message is not actually to encourage people in sin, but to simplify salvation for us. I decided to put the scriptures. It was only one scripture the Lord quoted, but I inserted these scriptures so that you will know that this message is scriptural. Let's continue with the message. Remember that disobedience is a sin. The rejection of being washed clean by the blood is disobedience. No unclean thing shall enter my holy kingdom. Revelation chapter 21, verse 27. Let all those who fall rise up. Their fall does not stop me from saving them. But their refusal to rise up and their resolution to team up with Satan, my enemy, to live in unrighteousness is what leads to their rejection. Tell my children that I know that they could fall if they are not on their guard enough. But their fall does not make me to pluck them off the vine. Rather, I keep calling them to repent. And I also supply them with enough grace to enable them to get back to me. I do not throw away those I have saved because they are weak. Rather, I supply them with more grace to enable them to overcome the infirmities of their flesh. Romans 5 verse 20b says, but where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. Have I not known their weaknesses before I saved them? Why should I throw them away because of their weaknesses? Tell them that the path of holiness and perfection is a journey. Nobody becomes perfect the very day they are saved. Tell my children not to get discouraged because of their imperfections. My grace is able to keep them. Therefore, let them not pluck themselves off from me. Tell them that all of them are in different spiritual classes. I mark their scripts according to their classes. I am their judge. Therefore, let them not condemn themselves when I have not condemned them. I do not call them to judge them, but that they may escape the judgment. This is why I do everything possible to save them. I have not come to condemn the world, but to save it. John 3:17. Let all those who have condemned themselves remove themselves from the position of the judge. I have not condemned them. Let them not condemn themselves. the Lord is saying here that a lot of people are condemning themselves. He is the judge. He marks our scripts. Why are we putting ourselves in his own position of judgment and start judging ourselves? I'm not saying that we shouldn't assess our own works. Yes, we should assess our own works. We have our conscience. We have our own conscience, which is our own judge. We should assess everything we do. We should, according to the amount of knowledge we have, the amount of God's word that we know, we should assess everything we do. I'm not saying that we shouldn't assess ourselves. We must assess ourselves, because we have a living conscience. But we are not permitted to judge ourselves and condemn ourselves. Examining ourselves is different from judging and condemning ourselves. That is what God doesn't want us to do, because a lot of times the devil comes to judge us and he tells us that we are not good enough and that we need to stop. That voice is not the voice of God. If the Lord is chastising you, his chastisement is always backed up with encouragement. This is one of the ways you know that the voice you just heard is not of God. If the devil is speaking to you, he condemns you and he discourages you. But if it is the voice of God, God will condemn your action, chastise you. Sometimes you even weep. But at the end of it, he encourages you. Read the book of Hosea. Read the book of Amos. He backs up his chastisement with encouragement. And he tells you, you have to move on. And it is the encouragement that actually leads to repentance. Read Romans 8, 33 and 34. Even we have no right to condemn ourselves. Jesus Christ is the judge. And then the Lord said to me, repeat after me, salvation is free. Then I said, salvation is free. Then he said to me, I watch my children as they grow and pass from one class to another. I know their strengths and abilities. I discipline them when they are lazy, stubborn, and disobedient. My discipline is to enable them remain in my love. My love corrects. Revelation chapter 3, verse 19. As they grow, I increase my expectations. Tell my children that the kingdom of God is a kingdom of discipline. This is why all those who have been saved by grace must put in their best according to the amount of grace apportioned to them to live a holy life. Holiness is the lifestyle of the kingdom. I admit weak people into this path of holiness and I help them to grow. It is a journey that I take with them. He said, it is a journey with them through the enablement of my grace. I do not expect perfection from them the very day they are saved. Tell them that I am loving and patient. My grace is sufficient for them all. Read Exodus chapter 34, verse 6, Numbers 14, 18, Psalm 86, verse 15, and 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Verse 9. The Lord God Almighty doesn't want the death of a sinner. I believe this message is simple enough. God will never throw you away because of your weaknesses. There are times those who are into different kind of addictions contact me. And you could hear this voice of condemnation, very strong voice of condemnation. Oh, I'm not good enough. I think I need to give up. Why do I even need to try? I keep falling over and over and over again. Don't give up. The fact that you are falling does not mean that you are not a child of God. You are in one of the lowest spiritual classes. That doesn't mean that you are not saved. You are saved. Remember, Jesus did not come for the righteous. He came for people like you and I, to save us from our weaknesses. It is not the very day that you get saved that your addictions will vanish away. There are some that will vanish away. There are some that you may need to struggle with them for a while, and then you come out strong and you start telling people that I used to be a smoker, I used to be a fornicator, I used to be this, I used to be that. I know a man who smoked India hemp for 50 plus years. He used to tell me that, my son, I don't think I can overcome this. But I used to tell him, you can, just trust in God, believe in God. The good news is that today he no longer smokes India hemp. He doesn't smoke anymore. That is what God's grace can do. Please cast all your weakness upon him. The fact that you are repenting every time you fall shows that you are alive in Christ, and the grace of God is sufficient for you to overcome. Don't condemn yourself. Do not say because you fell yesterday, you are not going to try today again. Keep moving. The grace of God is sufficient for you. The church is a hospital. All kinds of people that are sick come to the church with one agenda, with one primary motive. They want to be healed. Nobody goes to the hospital because they want the doctor to keep their sicknesses alive. They go to the hospital because they want to be treated. As you come to the church, as you come before the Lord, tell him you want to be healed. Don't come and start pretending. Imagine someone having terminal diseases, having terrible sicknesses, and they are pretending before the doctor that they are well, that they are okay. You will kill yourself. Come before the Lord. Cast all your burden upon him. Cast your weaknesses upon him. Do not be shy. I remember when I was to fall in the year 2007. I told my mom that now it is very difficult for me to resist temptation. I remember as I was on the way, I was a motorcyclist. I used to use my motorcycle to do public transport. There was a day I took a lady's phone number. She was beautiful, and I took her phone number. When I got home, I called her. Where are you? She said she was in the market. After I made the call, I asked myself, Hosanna, you used to preach. The Lord has called you. You know you would work for God. Even if your disobedience made you stay away from the church and you're arguing with God. You know the truth. If this girl comes here now, what will you do with her? You would fornicate with her, right? I questioned myself and I said, what have I just done? Did I collect a lady's number and I called her on the phone? Now it has come to the point that I want to commit fornication after I have preached to people. It was a terrible moment of my life. Some of you may not know, yet 2005, after the Lord called me, the call came with Holy Ghost baptism. Although I knew I would do the work of God. Some of you may not understand why I was blaming myself so harshly for calling a lady. March 21, 2005 was the day I got my call officially, and the Lord spoke to me and spelled out everything, and he told me how far the church was from him. When the Lord opened my eyes to see some highly placed and respected men of God, And the Lord told me how far they were from him and how much they are deceiving his children. I was angry. A lot of things made me grow angry. Children possessed with witchcraft, and I was questioning the justice of God. And I told myself, I'm not going to go to church, I'm not going to do the work of God until God explains to me why some of these things I call injustice on his side are happening. And from 2005 to 2007, I stopped going to church, even though God was sending me to some churches and he was revealing some things to me to convince me that I was wrong, that I needed to repent. So 2005, 2006, 2007, I was away from the body of Christ. In fact, it became too terrible for me that I even wanted to die. I asked God to kill me. But Satan crept in. If you remove yourself from the body of Christ, no matter whatsoever reason you have, your fire is going to go down. So my fire started going down. It went down to the point that I took the phone number of a lady because I wanted to sleep with her. But after I dropped the call, I wept and I repented. I asked God to have mercy upon me. Some minutes later, she called and I told her never to call my line again, that I don't know her. Do you know what I did that moment? That season, I told my mom, I told my two brothers that I can't stay alone. My immediate elder brother was staying in the same city with me in Warri. I told him I wanted to go and stay with him. He refused. I told my mom to beg him, because if I am down spiritually and I'm staying alone, it's dangerous. So I wanted to stay with him, to live with him. He refused. He said, no, I shouldn't stay with him. One day before he came back from work, I packed my things. I moved into his apartment, because I never wanted to fall. I have seen weaknesses and the Lord saved me. I have never been strong all the days of my life. I have had moments of weaknesses. So don't condemn yourself. Don't say because you fell yesterday, you are not going to serve the Lord, you don't want to rise up again. Why condemning yourself? Why are you placing yourself in the position of God and condemning yourself? Despite my weaknesses, do you know, since the moment I gave my life to Christ, I have never fallen into the sin of fornication any day. The Lord has kept me. He can keep you too. The Lord has kept me. Despite my weaknesses, the Lord kept me. Don't hide your sicknesses. That is why I told you that story. Don't hide it. Any moment of my life that I see that my level of self-control is dropping, I cry out. I tell my prayer partner, remember me in prayer. I'm not as strong as I used to be. Don't hide your sickness. The Lord is the doctor. He has come because of people like you. So why are you hiding your sickness from the doctor that's supposed to save you? Cast your burden upon him. Cast all your cares upon him. Cast your judgments upon him. Cast all the condemnations you have given to yourself upon him. And the Lord is more than ready to save you. The fire of hell is too hot for you. Please call yourself to order. You need to repent. You need to come back to the Lord. If you are not saved, or you fell and you want to come back to the Lord and you need assistance, my contact details are on the screen. I am here to support you. Get back to the Lord. This is why I am here. you want to give your life to Christ, I want to pray with you. Oh Lord, our God, thank you for this word. You have simplified the gospel of salvation. Lord, help us never to condemn ourselves. You are the judge. We are not the judge. Lord, help us to follow you in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you for your word. Lord, as many that are ready to come back to you, accept them. May the Lord God Almighty accept you. May the Lord God Almighty bring you to his fold. And for those of you who have never known the Lord and you want to give your life to him, could you please just say this prayer after me? Lord Jesus, I have realized that I am a sinner. Forgive me of my sins. I repent of all my sins. And from today, I have a change of mind that I will follow your path of righteousness. Even though I am weak, I know you are strong. And your strength will be made perfect in my weakness. Lord, help me as I resolve to follow you today. Wipe my name off the book of death and write my name in the book of life. Lord God, I ask that you help me in this sinful world to follow you. As I repent of my sins, I ask that you release your spirit upon me and give me your grace and enable me to do your will all the days of my life. Thank you for answering my prayer, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. If you pray this prayer, I congratulate you, because this is a beginning of a new lifestyle. And I know, as I pray this prayer, some years ago, 22 years now, as I prayed this prayer and finally made up my mind to give my life to Christ, I believe the Lord Jesus Christ can still see you through. He will definitely see you through, because the same grace that is available to me, that same grace is available to you. God bless you. Please subscribe to this channel, Igul Ayopuna Global Outreach. There are other messages that the Lord has given to me. They are on the channels and also on my website, igulayopuna.com. Don't forget to share this message. Please make sure that you don't watch this video without sharing it. Share it to people. Thank you and God bless you. Bye-bye.